There is nothing like a love one. All right, guys. We're going to get started. Johnny Guy, why don't you pray for us? We'll bring you a mic. We'll come to you. Look at that. We are here to serve you. Let's get out of the way of that. Let's put this on. That's right in on my shirt.
I want to pray, Ken.
You want to pray too?
Yep.
All right. Well, you start and then take it to Johnny when you're done.
Okay.
Well, okay.
Dear Jesus.
Got you started. I'll take it.
Dear Jesus, we come to you today just ever so thankful and humble that we had in our lives man, it's just the experience of you, man. It's real, man. I know. I'm thankful. Just ever so thankful today, man. The light, the sun shining, man, just warms my heart, being around, getting hugs from all my brothers and sisters. And I want to pray for a message that is good, powerful, and that we get a lot out of it today. Maybe we continue just to grow and love one another. And I pray for the houses that you watch over them, man, and fill them full of your light, man, and just cast out any darkness of them, man. And just, full of just love, peace, and happiness, man. We love you, Jesus. It's all in your name
and prayer. Word. As we are getting ready to sing this song, Death Was Arrested, man, what Jesus has done through defeating sin and death on the cross, and as a response to that, Romans 12:1 tells us, because of all that God has done, because of what has been accomplished at the cross, because of what has been accomplished through the resurrection, the new life that Jesus has given us in response to that. So we don't worship and pray to try and earn something or something. Man, Jesus has already made a way. He's already done. It is finished. What needs to be done, this new life that he's given us. And so in response to that, and because of what Jesus has done, it says, give yourself as a holy and living sacrifice. And as I talked with the people at the jail this morning, I want to do the same thing with you guys. I just want to clear that up, because sometimes we can start to, in our own minds, try to think of what that really looks like and get overwhelmed by that. Go, what does it really look like to give myself as a living sacrifice? And I think it's this simple. The most simplistic definition of that would be to recognize that you desperately need Jesus. Not just in this moment, not just when you're in jail, not just when you're getting high, not when things are bad, but just all the time, that you just need Jesus. Every step, every breath. That's what it looks like. Just acknowledging, man, Jesus, I need you. I need you. I desperately need you. Because I think so often we come to this place where we recognize we need something. We might even recognize we need Jesus. And then what happens is, as time goes on and as things start to happen, we go about our own business and kind of do this thing where we go, I'll take it from here. And yet, being a living sacrifice to Jesus is just coming to him and going, man, I need you. I need you, Jesus. Recognizing your desperate need for Jesus every step. And so, as we sing this song in response, that's what it is. It's in response to what Jesus has done. That death has been arrested, death has been defeated, and now we can anchor our hope, our confident expectation in the end of the movie, right? What's to come? Not just floating around on clouds, playing some harps, but man, reigning and ruling with Jesus on a new heaven and a new earth forever. Like, that's the end game, right? That's the end result. That's the end of the movie. That's where you anchor your hope. That's your confident expectation. And so we are, pouring the breath in our lungs out to Jesus during the song, because he has arrested death. He has already defeated death. He's already defeated sin, and we are anchored in what's to come. So let's worship the King.
Washes over.
so listen, so just as I'm thinking about this song, I Surrender, I love this song. Everybody knows this song. I just want to clarify, Jesus is putting on my heart, guys, that it's one thing, man, to say that you surrender, but it's a whole different thing to really surrender, man. A lot of people, including myself, in my life, have been in a place like I'm surrendered, but you're not really surrendered. And so this is a moment and stuff, guys, here while we worship the King of the universe, the King of this world, to really lay ourselves at his feet, knowing that we cannot do anything without him, and truly surrender in this moment.
I surrender.
be the cry of our hearts, everyone.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer.
That should give us some peace. I am yours. one of these. If you have your Bibles, turn to Romans chapter 1. Just like that last song that we were singing. It's all about putting our heart at Jesus' feet. Going through Romans chapter 1. Some of you might be familiar with it. Some of you might not. What I can tell you is probably some things are going to sting a little bit as we head through Romans chapter 1 today. At the same time, it's all for good. It's all to result in joy. It's all to result in freedom. As we head through here, if we can take our hearts and who knows, here's a quick question, a quick quiz question, and it, you can't answer it if I talk to you about it. Who knows what my shirt is? Anybody? You can't. You already know. I told you. So it's the Jedi symbol. I just want to get that out there real quick because, you know, I know the next thing that I'll hear is it's Illuminati or something crazy, you know, Ken and his mind control. So listen, I guess it is a Jedi symbol. And so, you know, you will lay your heart at Jesus' feet. That's what I'm hoping. That's my prayer, though. Seriously, guys, my prayer as we go through this, like I said, some things are going to sting a little bit, but all for good. You can't read through Romans chapter 1 without getting stung a little bit, but also for redeemed people who have new life in Jesus, you also read through Romans chapter 1 and you are just so grateful and so thankful for the new life that Jesus has given, for what he's done, for what you don't have to do anymore, for what you don't have to put up with anymore, for the change in your destination. From where we are headed to where we are headed now. And so, like I said, we're going to be in Romans chapter 1. I'm going to start at verse 16 and read to verse 32. And but this is the thing that I'm praying, like I said, that'll happen, man, that Jesus will speak his truth to our hearts, and it will accomplish all that he wants it to. And just so you know, as I was telling people earlier today that, you know, God's will for your life is a lot less about something he wants you to do and something that he wants to do with you. So if you can grab that, hold on to it. God's will for your life is not about something that he wants you to do so much, but something that he wants to do with you. And so I know that as we go through this today and we put our hearts out there for Jesus to have his way with our hearts, that his will for us is good. As we were talking about our destination and where we're headed and anchoring our hope in eternity, reigning and ruling with the King of the universe for an eternity on a new heaven and a new earth, that's his will. His will is that you would be redeemed. His will is that then he would use you to redeem the rest of his creation. And we were joking a little bit over here at a table because I almost fell off hanging the camera up and died. And I was like, that would just make sense, right? 26 years on the streets, everything Jesus took me through, and I would fall off a chair and just die. And I think it was Missy that said, oh, it's not going to be skydiving, huh? And I was like, yeah, that would be, I always have that thing where Jesus would know that you jumped out of a plane and you died and you'd get there. So it'd be a rhetorical question, but mm-hmm. Jesus would go, oh, so what were you doing? What were you doing? Really? Jumping out of a plane? To reach what lost people group? Oh, it wasn't? Oh, just for a rush? Yeah. So that's us. So as we head through here, we want to put our hearts at Jesus' feet. We want his word to accomplish all he wants it to, which is really freedom. Which is really, you know, this new life that he has for us and just this freedom from sin that he offers at the cross. And so I'm going to start in verse 16. It says, "For I am not ashamed of this good news about Christ. It is the power of God at work, saving everyone who believes. The Jew first, and also the Gentile. That would be us. We are the Gentiles, the outcasts, right? The non-Jewish people. So, also the Gentile. This good news tells us how God makes us right in his sight. This is accomplished from start to finish by faith. As the scriptures say, it is through faith that a righteous person has life. That is his will for your life, is that you would actually experience life. But God shows his great anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and the sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God. You see this? He goes, hey, nobody has an excuse for not knowing God, that you can look around at everything that he has created. You can clearly see his divine nature, his power. There's no excuse for not knowing God. Verse 21. Yes, they knew God, but they wouldn't worship him as God or even give him thanks. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. As a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshiping the glorious and ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. So God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshipped and served the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, he abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. Their lives became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. They are backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning, and they disobey their parents. They refuse to understand, break their promises, are heartless, and have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too. So listen, I want to start real quick by acknowledging that there's real hurt that has happened to people, okay? Because what we're talking about this morning is you're not the victim. Okay, and so I want to start by acknowledging that there's real hurt that's happened. There's real things that have happened to us that we've done to people, and there's real hurt. And so, like, in an earthly sense, there's victims, right? That there's people who have been victims to crimes and rapes and other things like that. And so, in an earthly sense, I acknowledge that that has happened, and I would classify those as little v's. Okay, because what I want to do today is, as we go through some of these things, I want to define these things biblically, all right? That the Bible should be what defines things for us. And so some of this stuff is going to be redefining, and not that we're making up a definition for it. We're going to look at Scripture and go, man, what does Jesus say the definition of these things are? And so in a worldly sense down here, hey, yes, we know that there is crimes and hurt and pain and stuff like that that happens. But really, even the definition of a victim down here is somebody who's innocent. Okay? Somebody who's innocent, that a crime has happened, an accident has happened, and they are completely innocent. And as we look at the biblical definition of a victim, It is someone who is pierced to death. Someone who is pierced to death. Does that sound familiar? It's the cross when you think about it. Someone who is pierced to death or a sacrifice. Okay? That word victims is used when they were bringing sacrifices to the altars. And those were supposed to be what? You know, spotless animals that were perfect and brought to the altars, a sacrifice to God. And so that's the biblical definition of what a victim is. And so in a worldly sense, we've got little v's, but really there is only one victim, okay? And as we went through this, you can clearly see who that is. That's God. God is the only real victim. And so on a cosmic level, everyone else stands guilty. Okay, that's why Jesus, when he came, he didn't come to judge the world because it had already been judged and found guilty. Already had been found in opposition to him as we went through here. I don't think that anybody reading Romans chapter 1 would read that and be like, I've never done any of that stuff. Right? Nobody's going to do that. And if you do that, man, praying that the blinders fall off today. That Jesus opens your eyes clearly so you can see what it means to be in opposition to Jesus and what it means to really be a victim. Because, look, this is the same thing. This is this question that's always asked, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, the problem with that question is it's loaded because there's no real good people. Okay? And so that's why people go, why do bad things happen to good people? Why does God throw people in hell? Why would a loving God do that to good people? And it's like, that's because there's no good people. There's only one who's good, and that's Jesus. Okay? And so as we go through this, you see that God is the victim. He's the real victim in creating all of us to worship and glorify him for the praise and honor of his name. And we have, you know, rejected him. We have rejected him all at one point or another, or still in that. So really my prayer today is, as it starts here and it says what, for I'm not ashamed of this good news, that we're talking about the gospel here, that Jesus has come to earth and died to redeem and restore his creation. And so even those hurts that have happened, those real things that have happened down here, man, Jesus offers healing for all of that. And so my prayer today is that, you know, those that are still found an enemy of God at the end of this will no longer be an enemy of God, because they will really come to a place of complete surrender to Jesus. And those who are playing the victim mentality, because let's just be honest, we live in a world where the world, Satan, and your shameful, sinful desires all say that you're the victim. All say that you've been wrong somehow. I mean, it's everywhere. Let me just tell you, we were gone for a couple days. Missed you guys. But we stopped at a restaurant to eat. And we got out, you know, and there's all six of us. And so it's like one of those clown cars when you stop somewhere, you know, and you get out. And there's like, oh, and you forget kids and things are going on. And so Delilah finally gets out of the car. And she comes up to me and she's whining. And I go, what's wrong with you? And she goes, I was in the back seat, and Abel locked the door on purpose, and he shut it. And I'm like, however did you get out? Right? So even at a very young age, you see this victim mentality where it's just like, I've been wronged, do something. And that's why we run around, because a victim mentality leads to what? It leads to like, man, I'm owed. I'm owed something, I deserve something, and really what starts to happen, even when you are wronged, you start to go for what? It's not really justice, but you start to go for revenge, and that's what starts to happen. And that's why Jesus makes it very clear, man, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. And he even gives us a way out of some of these real hurts that happen where people have hurt you, that if you are in Jesus, that if your life is hidden in Christ, man, that Jesus goes, I will make things right. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. And so, and the victim mentality that's here, and you just see it everywhere now in our world. It's like, man, you're owed reparations and all kinds of stuff is going on. And it's just like, you've been wronged. How could somebody look at you like that? How could somebody tell you no? Look at you. Nobody can tell you no. Are you kidding me? That is like one of the most heinous words in our world right now, and it's definitely always been since we opened Really Recovered. Like, you say no, and it's just like you just wait for the fallout, right? And so anytime the word no is said, it's like, oh my gosh, nobody can tell you no. You're owed something. You deserve something. And so what happens is, you know, when you have this victim mentality, you start to make excuses all the time for your sin, and it's always somebody else's fault, and something was done to you, and that's why you're this way, and that's why you hold on to this stuff, and it's always an excuse. And really what the victim mentality is all about, and this is why your sinful desires inside point to you, and you're the victim, and this is why Satan loves to whisper in your ear and go, man, they can't talk to you like that. You know, and that's why the world tells you, like, hey, man, nobody can tell you what to do. You do you, right? And if somebody doesn't let you do you, man, then they're just not living in the real world. And it's about you. And so all those things focus on what? You. You. And yet Jesus came to earth, died, rose from the dead so that you could have freedom from you. And so, like, man, that's such a freeing thing when you really get it. And that's been my prayer for this. And I'm not going to lie, man. Jesus is like, hey, you're preaching, you're not the victim, and you're preaching Romans 1 this week. And all week, I was like, oh, really? I got to go and do Romans 1. And listen, I know you guys all think, like, I love confrontation and all that or something, and getting so bold. But it's like, man, even with that, it's like, man, we're going through Romans 1. I just know what comes along with that. And even for me, as I'm looking at it and just thinking, man, what does it really look like to be a living sacrifice for Jesus? You know, it gets me grounded on what's really important. And so there's going to be a couple responses as we go through this. But my hope, my prayer is that it will set you free from you. It will set you free from you. Because if you are not set free from you, man, you're going to just keep ending up in the same place, and you're going to be stuck in the same vicious cycle. And there's nothing better than being free from self. That's it. That's why Jesus goes, man, deny yourself. Crucify yourself. He constantly knew. He's like, man, it's so bad. You need freedom from self. And so we look at this in the gospel. It starts with the gospel, the good news that Jesus died, and it's the very power of God at work, saving everyone who believes. And it shows us how to be made right in God's sight. What this means is to be justified, to be found not guilty in God's sight. And it's accomplished from start to finish by faith. And let me just tell you something as you think about what faith is. I want to, like I said, define things as we go through here today. Let me just say this. Faith shows the reality of what we hope for, okay? So you can see faith. It's not a mystical thing. It's not blowing in the wind, and you're like, oh. It's you can see it, right? It shows what you hope for. And so as I talked with the inmates today, I said, look, when they say, hey, pack and drag, right? And you're getting out, and you think you're getting out of jail, and you grab your mat and everything, and you know they got their little box, and they're all smiling on the elevator, and like, yeah, man. And 2 days ago, they were like, I really need help, I really need Jesus. Now they're on the elevator, and they're smiling, like, where are you going? Like, I want to get out. You know, they're just all excited, but they have this confident hope as they're headed down the elevator, and they're going to get out. And then a couple times what happens is they get down there, and they're like, oh, yeah, there's a holder, or there's this going on, and they send you back up. And they're just crushed because what? Hope isn't something you're just wishing. You have a confident expectation that something's going to happen. And when that doesn't happen, man, it feels like the whole world just caved in. And so, listen, faith shows what your confident hope is in. Faith shows the reality of what you hope for. And so you can see faith. And all through Scripture, Jesus saw people's faith. And he healed in response to faith. And he said, seeing their faith, he healed them. Seeing their faith, he touched them. You can see faith, okay? And so this is accomplished from start to finish through faith. And so what? The cross reveals his love. What an awesome, awesome gift to be able to constantly look at the cross and see, man, yes, Jesus loves me. That Sunday school song that you learned, the Bible tells me so, absolutely. Man, Jesus loves you. You can look at the cross and go, man, I know that Jesus loves me. And I know that people will tell you, even if it was just you on this earth, he would have died for you. And I don't know, it's not really biblical. But, okay, because that's the thing we start to do again. We start to make it about us. But, man, he wanted to fill the whole earth with his glory, okay? So it wasn't going to just happen with you. And so there had to be more. But, yes, Jesus loves you. He has died for you. He has been raised to life for you. And he is sitting in heaven right now rooting for you, pleading for you that when you screw up, man, as you're following him and you slip and stumble and whatever, man, he reaches down and he is quick to grab you up and he steps in front of the wrath of God and goes, no, they belong to me. They belong to me. And so the cross shows his power, his saving power, the power of God at work, that he is doing something in us, he's doing something through us, and it reveals victory over sin and death. And for the redeemed people who have really put their confident expectation and their hope in Jesus, they have everything they need. And then you get to verse 18 and it says this, but God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky through everything God made. They can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, so they have no excuse for not knowing God. He shows his great anger from heaven. And so the same thing, the cross, which is the expression of God's great love for his creation, is also the expression of his anger against sinful, wicked people. The same thing. And I know you're going, whoa. How can that be? How is that possible? Those things seem like a contradiction, yet they're reconciled at the cross through the death of Jesus, where Jesus, who is the victim, then steps in the way and takes the punishment for his attackers. Okay? And so the same expression of God's love is also the same expression of his anger. And it's against who? It's against sinful and wicked people. And so when there's a victim, there's always an assailant or an attacker. That is the opposite side of that. And so let's define some of this stuff real quick, because basically what does it say? It says through everything God has created, you can clearly see who he is and see his invisible qualities. And so the purpose of his creation was for what? And this includes you. The purpose of his creation through everything God made is so you can clearly see who he is. You can clearly see his power and you can clearly see his divine nature. And so when your existence here does not display God's glory, you are on the side of assailant. You are on the side of the attacker. That Jesus is the victim, and when you open your mouth to cheer for Jesus, it's crucify him. That's what it looks like. When your existence, because that's what you were created to do, was to bring glory to God, when your existence does not bring him glory, okay, you are an attacker. You are the assailant to Jesus. This is what the Bible says. And so nothing displays Jesus' glory more than worship. And so I think it's really important that we define what worship is. Because let me just give a public service announcement. Just because you show up here and yell some songs on Sunday, right? Or even yell into a microphone for a little bit, it does not mean that you worship. You understand that? Because that's not what worship really is. Let me give you the definition of worship. Jesus tells us what this is in Romans 12:1. He says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because all he has done for you. There it is again. Because of the cross, because of the new life he's offered you, in response to that you give your bodies to God and let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship. And so what is true worship? It's what you give yourself completely to. It's what you give your life to. It is what you are consumed with. It is what your thoughts are consumed with. It's what your heart is consumed with. It's what you give your life to. Now listen, if you flip burgers over at the McDonald's, praise Jesus. You better be flipping those things for Jesus. That better be the reason that you do that. That when you work, that nothing you ever do is useless when you do it for Jesus. That would be the ultimate reason. I worked a job. It was a very good job. Really recovered, started. And you know what changed? My whole job went to ministry. I was like, that's why. My whole job at the jail right now goes to ministry. That's what it's for. Okay, now I'm not saying you got to work and go, because here we go. Like, Ken wants us to give it all an offering. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm telling you is whether you eat, whether you drink, whatever you do, you're to do it for the glory of God. That ultimately, no matter where you're at or what you're doing, you better be worshiping Jesus. His divine power and qualities and nature should be seen in and through you. And so, true worship, man, is when it's whatever you completely give your life to. Now listen, as we read through some of this stuff, you know that I went over stuff that, like, yeah, some of you, it used to be what you completely gave your life to. Some of you, it still is. And at the root of it, if some of those things that we went through, being outside of Jesus' design, or, you know, greed or envy or any of these things, and you're consumed by any of these things, ultimately at the root of that, it's you. And so what happens is you find yourself usually worshiping you. You don't really realize it a lot of times. You can't see it clearly, but everything that you're giving your life to comes back on you. I'll never forget when I saw this clearly with my kids, where I was like, man, I want my kids to spend time with me. And it was all about me. It wasn't even like, oh, man, like I want to spend time with my kids for them. Everything, you know, just always came back to me. And it was always about me. And there's usually some emotions attached to it and everything. And we'll get to that. So listen, everybody is created to worship. Everybody was created to worship. We know this because you were made through Jesus and for Jesus. So you were made to give your life to him, to truly worship him. A living sacrifice. Here we go. I give my life completely to you, Jesus. And so everybody is worshiping. Everybody is worshiping, just not everybody's worshiping God. And so, that's the definition of worship as we head through this. Because the next thing I want to define is the redeemed, or the righteous, or the person who has left the victim mentality and went to victor. Who is living in victory, okay? Romans 1:5 defines this for us. It says, through Christ, God has given us the privilege and authority as apostles to tell the Gentiles everywhere what God has done for them, so that, so listen, man, we got to tell people about the gospel and what Jesus has done so that they will believe and obey him, bringing glory to his name. So at the beginning of this same chapter, it tells you exactly what it looks like to be redeemed, to be righteous, to go from, man, this victim mentality where you think everything's about you and you're the victim, to recognizing that, man, Jesus is the victim and I have been his assailant and his attacker, an enemy of God, and to be able to what? Be reconciled to him, to have this new life, and to what? Believe and obey. And I love that because those things are used interchangeably a lot in Scripture. I know people don't like to talk about obedience a lot, but they're used interchangeably all the time. To believe and obey, that this is a package deal. This is a package deal. Why? Because obedience is obviously true worship. I give my life to you, Jesus, and now anything you want me to do, of course I want to do it. And once again, remembering that it's less about what you want to do or what he wants to do, you to do for him, but what he wants to do through you. Okay? So it's not so much still again about what he wants you to do for him, but what he wants to do through you. Okay? And that's what obedience is really about, is following Jesus, walking with him closely so he can do something in and through you. And so obedience is true worship, and it shows our love for Jesus. I mean, you ever just thought, man, thinking about Jesus and thinking about the cross and going, man, just being overwhelmed by the love of God and by Jesus' love? And if you haven't, man, you're missing out. You're missing out. That's why you're still not free from self. But when those moments happen and I'm sitting there so focused on the cross, so overwhelmed by his love, you just have this feeling where you're just like, I just want to love on you, Jesus. Where you wake up and all of a sudden you're like, man, instead of just coming into the throne room and going, love on me, love on me, love me, you just come in there and you go, man, Jesus, you love me. I'm free from self. I'm not tossed around by my emotions anymore, and I just want to love you. And then the Bible tells us exactly how to do that. But those who obey God's word truly show how completely they love him. That is how we know we are living in him. That our lives are a living sacrifice for him. It's because obedience is true worship. That's what it is. And so the next thing I want to define is the attacker. The simple, wicked people. Because he shows what? His great anger at the cross where his wrath was poured out and Jesus steps in front and takes it. And so how do we define the sinful, wicked people? I love this because I've just been trying to keep it really simple for people. Here, it's in the same text, Romans 1:25. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the things God created instead of the Creator who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen? Anyone who does this is the attacker, okay? Or the assailant, and Jesus is your victim. Anyone who worships and serves the things that Jesus has created instead of him who created it, this is where you find yourself. This is how you are an enemy of God. And the only way to be reconciled is to turn from that and turn to Jesus and put your faith and your trust in him. That is what real repentance looks like. And so really, this is where we start to really see the wickedness of our heart. Okay? That everything is always about us and we're always using all the things that Jesus created for us and what they can do for us and how they make us feel. And it's usually always attached to emotions and feelings, you know, and just even thinking today about self-control and that being this awesome gift of the Holy Spirit, that when Jesus lives in you, like, you don't have to be tossed around by your emotions anymore. And Jesus goes, man, I give you a peace that's not from this world. That's the opposite of chaos. If you think about war and peace, war is what? People are getting blown up and dying and shot and all kinds of stuff. It's just chaos, but the opposite is peace. It's the absence of all that stuff. And what an awesome gift to put your faith in Jesus and actually have his spirit in you and not have to be tossed around by your emotions and your feelings and abusing the things that are created and making them about you. Now, this is this point in the sermon that I could, like, pull out an envelope and it could be the Maury show, right? And go, the results are in and you are not the victim, right? You are not the victim. Where you clearly see everything else, all of his creation clearly obeys and worships him. That the sun spins and goes exactly where he wants it to. The same with the earth. The oceans and the lakes, man, they stay in their boundaries where he put them. The stars come out when he wants them to. As we were driving here today, the sun was coming up. And Jesus was just doing his thing. And everything in creation, the plants give off oxygen so we can breathe. And we breathe out poison that they take in so they can live. And everything is just under his control and obedience and worshiping him. And then there's us. And then there's us. And what do? We think we're owed something and we're the victim and we deserve and all this other stuff. And that's where our true wickedness starts to show. And so verse 21 is what it says. They knew God, but they wouldn't worship him. So there's an active rejection. They wouldn't worship him as God or even give him thanks. And they began to think of foolish ideas of what God was like. And as a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. So God abandoned them. to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. The reason we reject God and we don't worship Him as God is because we want worship. We have a God complex. We want to be the center. We want to be God. And what does it say? They make up foolish ideas of what God to be like. Not only do we do this, this is encouraged in our world. To make up a God of your own understanding. A God that essentially will what? Worship you. And we make up gods like ourselves. Because we think we're so great. And everything revolves around us. And so we have this God complex. And listen, if you make up and you decide who God is, you're playing God. And we make up a God that exists for us instead of recognizing God is for God. God is for God. And what an awesome opportunity we have to be a part of bringing Him glory and praise. That He would include His assailants. That He would include His attackers. That He would include His creation that He made, that instead of worshiping Him, man ran around and worshiped and served the things and the people that He created. And yet, in His love is so great that He steps in and goes, I still want you. I still want you. And let's just be honest, as we play God, we don't even know what that's like to do that for somebody else, right? Somebody's wronged you and it's just, man, you're done with them forever. Have nothing to do with them. And yet Jesus, who is love, who is the definition of love, steps in and goes, I'll take my attackers. And so their minds become dark and confused, and we start to take on this victim mentality, like we've been wrong, things aren't working out for us, and really what's happened? God has abandoned us. He's abandoned us. He goes, okay, little G, drop an album. Let me hear what you got. Right? You want to play God? Okay, little G, let me hear it. And what is it? These two things that He abandons us to, our shameful desires and our foolish thinking. Our shameful desires and our foolish thinking. See, so often we're like, I want this, I want this, I need this, I need this, I need this. And then Jesus just sometimes just takes His hand off and goes, go ahead. Because sometimes you got to get what you want to find out that it's not what you need. And so He just steps back and goes, okay, little G, go ahead. Show me how it's done. Show me how it's done. You know so much. You know, in the book of Judges, He goes, call out to the gods that you've made to save you. Why are you calling to me? That person, that girl, that guy, whoever it is that you've put above Him, those kids that you've put above Him, that stuff that you've put above Him. He goes, why aren't you asking that for help? Why aren't you asking that for help in your time of need? And yet, even in that, where people did whatever they thought was right in their own eyes, he finally, as they beg and they plead and they go, we know, we know, we know, we're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry. He is grieved by their misery. He knows they're miserable apart from Him. And He still goes, okay. And He comes to the cross. He still says, okay, and comes to the cross. And so what happens? He goes, go ahead and play God, and let's just look real quick at the dumpster fire we make when we're in control of the universe, right? Of our universe. And so the two things that He abandons us to are shameful desires, our foolish thinking, and these are the results. And as I go through these things, pay attention really carefully because they're all very emotionally fueled. Everything is emotionally fueled. Okay? And it's all about these emotions that we have tied to all these things. And so the first thing, when He abandons us to our shameful desires, it says what? Even the women turned against the natural way. So keep that in mind. Turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with others, with other women. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of the sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Is this talking about homosexuality? Absolutely. Is that a sin? Absolutely. You know what else it's pointing to? Being outside of his design. Turning against the natural way to do things, how he designed. And so, man, it's not just with sex, it's with everything else that Jesus has created, everything, including sex. And so he knows how best it's done for your joy and to bring him glory. And so when we were down in Millersburg, Megan is my co-pilot, and she's my navigator, and we left the restaurant tonight, and I said, which way do we go? And she goes, down this way. And I said, all right. And I go, now what? And she goes, turn right. And I got halfway into that turn, and it was a one-way. And there was a car coming straight at me. No pun intended. Going the wrong way, right? And so listen, this is what it's like when you're outside of Jesus' design. It's going to what? End in misery. It's going to end in misery because it leads to this penalty, this suffering within, this spiritual death. And so this is true with sex and everything. And look, we've made like some sins worse than other sins. And what Jesus is clearly saying here, look, you're gay, you smoke crack. Guess what? Deny yourself. It's the same thing. Man, deny yourself, turn from your sin, turn from your shameful desires, and do things Jesus' way. Because he knows what's best, and that's how it should be done. He's designed your life, he's designed everything about it, and so he knows what will not just bring you joy, but bring him glory. It's in his design. And I get it, you're like, well, people all the time come to me and they're like, oh, what if you're born that way? Jesus says you'll be born again. Right? He'll give you a new birth. So that's not going to fly. And that's with everything. I was born to smoke crack. Like, I could just say that about anything. You know? Jesus gives you a new birth. His spirit is now alive in you. And so what does it say? And they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. And so, listen, anytime you're indulging in your shameful desires, this, by the way, is the definition of losing control, okay? I was teaching self-control at the jail today, and I told them, when you go through the fruit of the flesh in Galatians, it says, when you give in to your shameful desires, this is what happens. And it's no different than this stuff right here. And so the definition of losing control is giving in to your shameful desires. That's what it is. And so anytime you indulge in your shameful desires, the result is spiritual death and spiritual suffering. And listen, really quick, because this is true for both non-believers, and spiritual suffering is also true for believers. You believe in Jesus, you have his spirit living in you. Let me just show you, let me just define this before everybody starts to get on, because I'm not here to have that talk about losing your salvation and all that crap. So listen, this is what we're about. So listen, the non-believers in spiritual death, Ephesians 2 verse 1 says this, once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. You're an attacker. You are an enemy of God. You are dead in your sins. Why? Because of your disobedience. Your disobedience and your many sins and giving in to your shameful desires. And what about the believers? Ephesians 4:30 says this, and do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, he has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. And so grieving God's Holy Spirit is spiritual suffering. You think about grieving and having sorrow and being sad. And now you just see Jesus hang on the cross, man, even in the garden. That's the same word in Matthew. I think it's in Matthew, I want to say 18. I don't know, but in Matthew, as he's heading into the garden, it says he was grieved with this suffering. And he's headed in to sweat blood. He said he felt like he was grieved to death. And so when you're giving in to your shameful desires, even as a believer, you're going to suffer spiritually outside of Jesus' design. And so this is true for both believers and non-believers. And I think it's just that Maury moment again, right? Where you just go, you're not the victim. In both of those scenarios, in both of those, non-believers, disobedience, your many sins, as a believer, disobedience, grieving the Holy Spirit about how you live, who's the victim? Jesus. In both of those scenarios, God's Holy Spirit, right? The Father. God is the victim in both of those scenarios. And so it's just like when I used to see my kids at the doctor's office and they had the little box and they had the little pegs and they were trying to shove a square one in a round hole. And they get all frustrated, right? And they're like, freaking out. And that's you outside of Jesus' design. When you're trying to do things your own way. It's like trying to force a square peg into a round hole. It's not meant to be that way. And so, when abandoned to their foolish thinking, here are the things that come up. Their lives became full of things, every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, gossip, backstabbers, haters of God, blaming God for things that happen. Insolent, proud, boastful, invent new ways of sinning. Just coming up with new ways to be disobedient to God. Refuse to understand. Break their promises. By the way, has anybody ever broke more promises to you than you? Just get that out there real quick. Always mad at everybody else. Man, they didn't keep their word. Man, you never have kept your word for you. You've made yourself all kinds of promises. Nobody's broke more promises to you than you. Heartless, have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those that do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway, and worse yet. It even gets worse than that. It's like, what could be worse than that? They encourage others to do them too. It's not bad enough that you're doing these things, man, but that you encourage others to do them too. This is what happens, little G. Right? This is your album. It would be called Dumpster Fire. And it's just all emotional, right? It's all about emotions. Emotions drive the things. Why do people kill? Why do people envy? Why? It's all tied to emotions. And 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 says, man, prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. The words used there are to be sober-spirited. Have a sober spirit. So what's that talking about? That you're free from the influence of strong emotion. Just like when you're drunk and you do a lot of stupid stuff and you're influenced by what you've drank and what you've consumed or drugs. When it's talking about have a sober spirit, that Jesus offers a sober spirit, that you're free from the influence of strong emotion. You just don't have to run around and be tossed around by all your emotions anymore, man. No, you have this self-control that Jesus is at work in you. And you're not just thrown around by your emotions all the time. Let me tell you something. People like this that are just, you know, worshiping the things of this world, that are just greedy and envious and all this stuff, this list of people doing things outside of Jesus's design, these people always play the victim. They always play the victim. There's always an excuse why they're this way. It's no more than even if there's been a real hurt, now they use it to their advantage to try and get what they want. And hurt people hurt people. And so they're not people that are redeemed and in Jesus and are about his glory now. They're not trusting in him. They're taking matters into their own hands, trying to fill their sinful desires. And even worse, they drag people to hell with them because misery loves company. Misery loves company. And here it is, Matthew 18:6. Jesus takes a little kid and he sits him on his lap and he tells his disciples that unless you become humble like this little kid and turn from your sins, you can't have the kingdom. And then he goes on to say, man, if you hurt one of these little ones, is he talking about kids? Sure. Was he also talking about little babies that have just put their faith in Jesus? That's what he was talking about. He goes, man, you cause one of these people to go off into sin? You drag them away from me? He goes, you should go tie a big rock around your neck and throw yourself in the sea and kill yourself. Now, listen, Jesus said it. Before everybody gets all hyper and crazy. Can you just tell me to kill myself? Like, Jesus said that. All right? It's in the Bible. That's why he said, worse yet, you encourage other people to do it too? And so we talked about how Jesus, though, in his love, grieved by our misery, that when we really cry out, man, he goes, I got a new life for you. You don't have to be, you know, imprisoned to self anymore. You don't have to be just influenced by your strong emotions anymore. You don't have to be the victim anymore. You don't have to be an enemy of God anymore. That the good news is that Jesus has died to reconcile us to himself. Colossians 1, 21 and 22. This includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. See how that lines up with Romans 1? He abandoned them to their shameful desires and their actions, and he abandoned them to what? Their foolish thinking. He goes, even them, right? Even us, we were his enemies. And he goes, and I died for you while you were still my enemies. That's the love of Jesus, so that we could be reconciled to him, and as the result, we would be holy and blameless without a single fault in his presence. In his presence. Let me just define holy for you really quick, that God is above and beyond and set apart from everything else. He is unique, above and beyond everything else. He is the treasure that makes treasure, right? He's the treasure that makes treasure. And so when it talks about us being holy, it's because he lives in us, and what? Really simply, he's cleaning us up. You cannot clean you up. Guess what? I can't clean you up. Really recovered cannot clean you up. Jesus at work in and through his people and his church at Really Recovered, Jesus can clean you up. That's what he wants to do. That's his will for your life, is to make you more and more like him. So even when you follow him and they're suffering, it's so easy to feel like the victim. Guess what? You're not the victim. Guess what's happening? The whole goal was for you to be made like him. It says anyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus must suffer. That's not just some weird price to pay of admission that Jesus put together. He goes, no, no, no. You got to be made into my image. Guess what that means? You got to go through some suffering, man, to get rid of all the crap. To burn off all the crap. To be like Jesus. And so Jesus died on the cross to reconcile his enemies, his attackers. He takes the punishment, clears the record, and then get this. So going back to the beginning, the people that have experienced real hurt, that Jesus, through the gospel, offers what? He's our healer. He offers real healing for the deepest, darkest places of your soul. This is what it's talking about, 1 Corinthians 15:57. But thank God he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, on the surface, you just heard that. You went, yeah, I know, I got victory over sin. No. Think about what Jesus has done. victory over sin and death. So yes, on a level, a personal level, yes, victory over our sin and our death, that, you know, we are no longer slaves to sin, and we're not controlled by our sinful desires anymore when he lives in us, and we're not, you know, controlled by our foolish thinking anymore, okay? And that when we die, we won't really die. We'll be with Jesus for an eternity and come back and rule and reign with him on the new heaven and the new earth. But victory over not just our sin, but others. Other people's sin. Not just victory over our sin, other people's sin. This is 1 Peter 2, 21 through 25. God called you to do good, even if it means suffering. Just as Christ suffered for you, he's your example, and you must follow in his footsteps. He never sinned or deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted, nor threaten revenge. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judges fairly. Listen, you don't trust Jesus at all if when things get tough, when things hit the fan, you can't trust your case to the hands of God. Don't tell me how you trust Jesus when nothing's really happening. Yeah, easy to give lip service to that. And now you must suffer for doing good. And that means what? Other people's sin is going to affect you. And Jesus is your example. And what? Just as Jesus hung there on the cross and said, "And I leave my case in the hands of God who always judges fairly," we get to go, man, we know Jesus will take care of us, no matter what it is. And so now you have victory what? Over your sin. You have victory over other people's sin. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. By his wounds, we are healed. There's that healing for the deepest, darkest parts of your soul where people have really hurt you, and yet what? You get to move from, in Jesus, victim to victor. Victory over sin. And victory over what? Death. And I hit on it, our death. Yes, absolutely, that we will live with Jesus forever. But what? What else? Victory over other people's death. Some of us have suffered real loss. Heartbreaking loss. And yet, Jesus gives us victory over death. Even other people's death. And this is it. Psalm 119:68 says, "You are good and do only good." And so it's so easy to sit around here and wonder and what happened and what came next and all this stuff. But we know that Jesus is good and does only good. And so whatever judgment, whatever decision Jesus makes when sitting on the throne and somebody shows up, it's good. You can trust him. You can trust that it was good. And you don't have to be consumed by that anymore. And so I'm hoping today, guys, that there will be people that move from an enemy of God to a child, his kid. And people will move from victim to victory. And you can walk out of here completely free, completely healed, from injured to healed, from hate and anger and anxiety and all this stuff, man, to love and joy and a peace that doesn't come from this world. What an awesome gift of the gospel to have real peace and to not be under the influence of strong emotion anymore, constantly reacting to people and reacting to situations. But to be grounded and anchored in eternity. Jesus said, man, you can have peace in me. Let's pray.